We can see here the example of the IRBB positioning of the active management of the interest rate risk exposure of a bank on the short part of the curve. And here we have the horizon of gapping period equal to 12 months, and we see that the total gap, which is obviously asset minus liabilities, is positive. This is obviously due to the outstanding, to the difference in outstanding. The asset has a higher outstanding comparing to the liabilities. So the total gap is higher than zero, so it's positive. It means that theoretically, this position should behave in the way that if the rates go up, then the positive impact will be seen on the P&L. In terms of the P&L. Just the contrary, if the rates go down, there will be negative impact on P&L. However, as I said before, the outstanding is not everything. There is also the composition of the time factor, the component of the time factor. And the time factor means the frequency. So how frequent is the repricing of liability and where the next risk day is happening comparing to the cutoff date. So if the cutoff date is today and my liability is repricing within the next month, it means that there will be higher P&L impact than if we have the position which is repricing within the next 6 months, then the impact will be lower on the P&L because of the time factor. It means that the first date of the risk position and before the risk occurs, then we have higher risk exposure. If it occurs earlier, then the exposure to IRBB is higher. So this means that not only the outstanding determines if the total position is positive or negative in terms of directional gap. So here we have the directional, the total gap positive, but does not mean if the directional gap is also positive because it depends on the repricing frequency. In this case, it is very likely because we need to know exactly the time factor when these 50 millions of 50 units reprice in terms of liability and when exactly the asset reprices. So once we have it, we calculate the time factor. So the difference between the total gapping period minus the next next repricing day and the time which is left, so T capital T minus the lowercase t, which determines the impact which is here on the P&L in terms of the length the position have to the end of the repricing period, determines the exposure. The same situation we can see here, but there is the opposite. So the liability is 100 outstanding and asset is 50. It means that the position should be in terms of the outstanding negative. So there is the negative gap and the bank is exposed to the upward movement of the curve. Because of the negative directional gap and the higher the liability sensitive position. However, again, we need to take into account the time factor. So when the risk position happens, and then we can assess if the bank is asset sensitive or liability sensitive. So usually in the normal bank's activity, this is the tool which treasurer uses to assess if the exposure in terms of repricing gaps is okay in line with the future market predictions he or she has. If she or he expects there will be increase in rates in the near future, then obviously if he's positions as a negative liability sensitive or negative residual gap, then it means that he is running risk. he's running risk, and he should or she should do everything possible in order to close this exposure. In the contrary, just the opposite happens if she or he expects the decrease in interest rates. We can see the situation quite well here. So this is the typical example of the repricing gap analysis. So the repricing gap analysis, which I said is the frequency of different of repricing in terms of the residual gaps, so the, of the whole banking book. And we can see on this particular example that the banks have a quite significant position, which is repricing here in terms of almost 400 minus 400. So it means this is the negative liability sensitive position. This is a position which results from liabilities, repricing liabilities. And then there is there are smaller gaps on the asset sides, which are related to the asset position, the repricing of assets, which are of more than 300, and they are repricing one after another. Now, this is important thing to notice, that there there is the difference between the repricing gap analysis and refixing gap analysis. So I will be talking about the refixing gap analysis a bit later. This is the difference between the refixing, which is on the right side, and the repricing. You can see that the repricing gap is looking slightly different because it shows the first repricing date. So it does not show the next repricing dates of the same item. So if we see here this liability position is, for example, indexed to the 1 month because it's occurring within the 1 month time period. It means that it does not mean that this position will, after 1 month, will be seen again within the 1 month time period, because the repricing gap analysis that does not tell you what is the risk factor to which the position is indexed to. Here we just only know what is the next repricing, the next on the first from today repricing date of this position, but we don't know if this position is indexed to Euribor 6 months. So if so, we would see it again once after 1 month, we would see it in the 6 month time bucket. Or if it's indexed to Euribor or LIBOR 1 month, then you will see it in the 1 month time bucket. Or if it's indexed to the LIBOR 3 months, we'll see it in the 3 month time bucket. So here we don't have this information. We don't know what is the risk factor of the position. We just only see the next repricing in terms of the asset and liabilities of the positions in terms of residual gaps. Even we don't know how much exactly here is liabilities, how much is assets, because it is only the difference between assets and liabilities here on this particular graph. Instead, a refixing gap has the additional information. It also has the different objectives. So it is not to show the to measure the NII impact directly, or to assess the risk in terms of when we shock, what will be the shock, or if we have the asset sensitive or liability sensitive. So what should be the directional gap position? It does not answer those questions. Instead, it tells us what is the risk factor underlying the asset and liability position. In this case, we can see that we have the green bar, and the green bar represents the Euribor 3 months position, and it is only one position, but it is shown on the regular basis. So every 3 months, it is this position. This is particular position in this particular example because it is taken from the real case bank, and this bank had the risk factor of 3 months, but it was repricing. It was not standard indexation, so it was repricing on the monthly basis. So, but usually, if it's indexed to Euribor 3 months, you will see it, or you would see it in the next, after 3 months, and again after 3 months, so and so. And the same on the liability side, you see the blue bar. The blue bar represents Euribor 1 month, and it is related to liabilities. And you can see that those liabilities, this one position of liabilities, or this bunch of liabilities, is repriced, which are indexed 1 month. You will see them again after 1 month, and again, because this is the same position, which is shown in terms of the frequency of repricing. So you will see, and because it is obviously the risk factor, you see, you have the information of the risk factor, which is there. So this is the main difference between repricing gap analysis and refixing gap analysis. So once you write the ILM report, and we have this webinar, or not webinar, but the example of how to write the ILM report, which is also prepared in this trainings. So you can see that what to tell, what information is needed to your ALCO members, to the senior management, in order to assess the exposure on the short part of the curve, or and also in terms of basis risk. Here we are showing exactly their exposure to the basis risk of the bank, because the difference between the risk factors on the asset side and liability side. So there are different risk factors here. The green one is Euribor 3 months. On the liability side, we have the Euribor 1 month, and we have also some positions which are indexed to the other time factor, like Euribor 6 month and Euribor 12 month, which you should see on the frequency basis, on the regular basis. But you see the same position, which is shown several times. For example, Euribor 6 month will be seen twice if you have the gapping period of 12 months. The position Euribor 3 months will be shown 4 times, and Euribor 1 month will be shown 12 times. So this is exactly what you will see if you show over the time horizon of 12 months. So this is information which will tell you, be careful, there is discrepancy between the risk factors, so you can have the exposure to the uncorrelated movement of Euribor 1 month versus Euribor 3 months, and so on and so forth. So this is why you do this analysis. And repricing gap analysis is something different. As I said, you will see only the first repricing date. So you see here basically how to read this graph. What is it telling you? Obviously, you need to include the time factor, as I said, because if you have only the outstandings, repricing and outstanding, it does not give you the precise number of NII sensitivity, because you have to include the time factor. But at least you see that there is the exposure, which is quite significant in terms of the liability. So probably there is quite significant concentration in terms of floating rate funding, because fixed rate funding here we don't see under the time horizon of 12 months. You can see it, obviously, but this position is probably the floating rate indexation. It's repricing frequently, and this is also why I say it. It could be potentially the fixed rate position, which is expiring within the 1 month time period, and is related to the fixed rate bond, for example, or fixed rate time depot, fixed rate certificate of deposit or commercial paper. It could be theoretically. Here, I know that it is the floating rate position because it is the real case situation. So I know from knowledge of this bank particular institution that this position was a floating rate, and this the concentration is important. You don't have the different a number of gaps. So you see one gap only, and you see many gaps on the asset side. So it means that there is quite significant concentration in terms of funding. This is the first information you have. And the second one, that probably you won't have high NII sensitivity exactly for this reason, because those positive gaps will offset this negative gap, given that it is only the difference of in terms of month, that the time bucketing is monthly time bucketing. However, be aware that even though you can manage, you can obtain or achieve the total offsetting of gap, so the total gap almost zero, but it does not mean that there is no NII sensitivity, because as I said, there is time factor which matters. So let's see this exercise, and I will leave it to you, this exercise. This is something which I would like you to do by your own, on your own. So calculate the total gap in repricing and also the NII sensitivity based on the equation which I have provided before. So the gap multiplied by shock multiplied by time factor. And this is very simple calculation, but I would like you to think if it's positive asset sensitive position, or what can happen and what treasure of this bank should be aware of. And if it is liability sensitive, what he or she should do in order to manage the exposure. So this is something which I leave with you. Now I would like to show you the real case NII sensitivity analysis provided in one of the banks, smaller sized banks, which were under the process of being compliant with the Basel 368. And you can see that there is the split of the, so this is quite simple structure in terms of products. This is also because the bank is small size and it is Challenger Bank, which has several types of assets and several types of liabilities. And they are quite important information which you could potentially see in this graph, in this table. For example, this is the shock up. If I show you the shock down, then you would notice that there is particularity embedded into this structure. But this is not the objective of this particular webinar of the analysis. There will be the separate webinar which shows how to analyze exactly the result of EVE metrics, of the all metrics, IRB metrics with the objective variable, which is economic value, and all metrics with the objective variable impact on earnings. So here I just wanted to show that for NII sensitivity, first of all, you have here the behavioral view. And the behavioral view, it means that if the bank have some mortgages or fixed rate products with the early redemption feature, then there is possibility that there will be component in terms of prepayment, and then you would need to shorten the duration, and this will be the behavioral view because you will include the behavioral feature of the product. The same on the liability side. We see here clearly that the behavioral feature comes from the current account savings accounts, because we have here the non-maturity deposit. And this is why we are saying that it is behavioral view, because probably, and not probably, but for sure, those CASA are modeled, and the average maturity of this product is higher than contractual, obviously. The same if you provide some behavioral view, you include also some other components. For example, in terms of time depot, you maybe want to include the early redemption of time depot if there is a possibility. So you will all products which are modeled will be here in this table with the modeled characteristic, or according the modeled characteristics, because this is the behavioral view. And this is the shock up, parallel up. And as you can see, the bank clearly is the asset sensitive position, has the asset sensitive position. And it means that if the rates go up, the bank benefits from the rates going up. Now, as I said, I'm not going to, in this webinar, to analyze and to do the case studies, because it's not the objective of this webinar, but I want to just bring to attention that if you have this kind of information, you already know a lot about the bank. And if, for example, you see this number and you see 89% of NII sensitivity, obviously it is high. So it means that even if it's positive, but there is high sensitivity of NII, and not everyone, let's say, likes it. In terms of the regulator, does not like high volatility of NII. Senior management does not like, ALCO does not like. So it is something which not needs to be taken into account. Not only the negative impact and the variability, potential variability of non-NIM is important, but also even if it's positive, but too much, then it also has the negative negative. It is negative characteristic. So it's not positive because the margin is meant to be stable. Now let's think about the basis risk and the role of the basis risk in the repricing analysis. So on the left side, you have the example of the repricing profile. And again, I just wanted to repeat slightly under the different angle what I've already told under the fixing gap analysis. So here you see and the repricing view, repricing gap analysis, if something, some position is repricing within the next, let's imagine those two positions repricing within the next month, but they are offsetting each other. So theoretically, you don't see any gap there, and you don't think there is any impact on the net interest income. But if you look at the factors, risk factors, you see that on the asset side, the position is indexed to your LIBOR 6 months, on the liability side to 3 months. So if there is the non-parallel shock, so if, for example, the LIBOR 6 months moves differently from the LIBOR 3 months, then you will have the impact. And this is the situation when the basis risk damages the NII. So it's not under parallel shock, because under parallel shock, you won't have this impact. So there is, because both of them, LIBOR 6 months and LIBOR 3 months, will move by the same amount, up or down, because it's parallel shock. But if those parameters do not move in the same direction, so there is no parallel shock, there is definitely the impact on NII. And this is why you need to split those two analyses. So the fixing gap analysis and repricing gap analysis, they are two separate analyses of two different risk categories. The next one, and very much debated by Basel and by the final guidelines, which has been published in 2018, and about which we'll be talking quite a lot, is delta EVE. So the economic value of equity sensitivity. And Basel, this is exactly equation which is written, is described by the Basel's Committee Standards on IRBB, published in 2016 in April, and the same which has been endorsed fully by the final guidelines published by EBA, European Banking Authority, in July 2018. And this is the standardized methodology of calculation EVE of the EVE volatility, which is mandatory right now since 1st January. So the banks had time until the end of 2019 to adjust and to include those calculations into the suite of IRBB metrics. Right now, it is already mandatory. So you have the, let's look at every single component. So it is obviously the summation of discounted cash flows, because we have the discounted factor, where E is the shock, and C is the currency. So for every single shock, we are calculating the cash flows which are under the shock scenario and discount factor for the shocked scenario. Then we have also calculation of the cash flows in the base scenario, which here is represented by zero, so cash flows zero, and discounted factor at zero, so under base scenario. The last factor, last element of this equation is known as the difference in the automatic value of the embedded automatic optionality. So there are automatic options, as I said, those automatic options which can be both embedded or explicit. And explicit means that you have just separated positions in terms of interest rate optionality or swaptions. And swaptions are obviously the option as well. You have explicitly those positions in your on your banking book, or they are embedded into the contract of assets or liabilities. Let me provide you with an example. A very common example right now is to have zero floor, which is embedded into the contracts for the corporate loans, denominated in assets denominated in euro currency, because the rates are negative, in negative territory. So obviously the company protecting the banks are protecting themselves in case of the further decrease or reduction in rates. There will be no further impact on margin from those assets. So there is this zero floor. So basically, the interest rate component cannot go lower than zero. So if the rates are negative, there is no NII sensitivity at all associated to those assets. So you will see in this case, which I show you before, this bank had the corporate loans with zero floor. So under the negative 200 basis point shock down, you would see, or under whatever parallel shock down, you will see zero here, zero impact, because there are floors embedded. And there are also optionality in terms of floors embedded into the non-maturity deposits. So this is another optionality which, with according to the new guidelines, you have to calculate. It is not only the frequency of pricing, the average duration of non-maturity deposit, the pass-through rates. It is also the fact that those items have important embedded optionality, automatic optionality. And why it's automatic? Because it's considered automatic, because under the negative interest rate scenario, you won't reprice those depositors down. So you won't charge them, pass through them to them negative rates. And in this case, it's quite the drag on the profitability of banks, because this short optionality, short option position on the liability side will act as a drag on the P&L, on the profitability. You cannot, you don't want to lose those clients, so you don't charge the negative rates. And meanwhile, in the positive environment, you will adjust the rate. If the rates are going down, you will adjust accordingly to some extent the interest rate on the deposits for depositors, and then you will offset or mitigate the exposure to IRBB. In this case, you don't have it. So there is this short position, optionality position on the liability side, which it's basically very difficult to manage. Now, if the delta EVE and the shock scenario is higher than zero, then the economic value of the banking book is going to increase. So it is good, it is positive. If the embedded value, in case it is negative, the bank faces the reduction in its economic value. And then you will need to put the limit in order to set up your appetite and to the willingness of the bank to take on the certain exposure. The KAO factor, as I said, is this add-on for the calculation of the change in value of the automatic interest rate optionality, whether it is explicit or embedded.